good morning and happy Sabbath. Just waiting for my singing partner here. Okay, our first happy Sabbath, and our first song for today is going to be I Will Sing of Jesus' Love, and that's going to be 183.
How are you? Happy Sabbath.
Going to be, if you can rise, for Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, 290.
Yeah.
seated. Thank you and happy Sabbath.
There's a text in the Bible that says, I was glad when they said, let us come into the house of the Lord together. I'm so glad to see you all this morning. We had a compliment about our church. I had a speaker not too long ago. He said, your church is alive. He said, we've been to other churches where they're dying, but your church is alive. And we sense that. And a little later on, you're going to have, when we have the children's story, you'll see the little children come up here. And that's a sign that our church is alive. We would like to invite you to join our fellowship luncheon right after the service. A very delightful time, good food, and good fellowship. Fellowship's a really important thing in our church. And sometimes we underestimate it. But I think getting together and loving each other and talking about various things is such an important part of our church service. And we encourage you to participate in that pleasant event. A couple of things I want to bring your attention to. One is the insert about the capital campaign that goes for Wawona, Soquel Campground, and in educational endowments. That's something we can be aware of. And Arvidel is going to introduce our speaker right after the scripture reading. It's going to be a special time for us, so we're looking forward to that. Celia has an announcement.
Good morning, church family. I've got an announcement from the Seaside Church. They are going to be holding us an evangelistic series. It starts actually today at 7 p.m. It's nightly at the Seaside Church, like I said, in their 1600 Broadway Avenue. And the speaker will be Pastor Bobby Mitchell. It starts 7 p.m., except for Thursday night. They're going to skip one night. And then also, I couldn't come up front without talking about the women's tea. It's going to be next month. I've given invitations to several of you, and maybe I've missed a couple, but I'll get you, or hopefully find you today. So it's our women's tea is the 19th. It's Sunday here downstairs here at church at 11 a.m. Hope to see you there.
Seth Schumacher also has a little announcement for us.
How many of you get the Adventist Journal magazine? I think it's Journey magazine, okay. I was looking at my most recent one this last week, and there was an advertisement that said, The Hopeful in select theaters, April 17 and 18 only. And there's a website, www.thehopefulmovie.com. So I went on to take a look at it, and it apparently is the story of how the Adventist Church was founded, William Miller and Ellen White early on. And it is playing at the Del Monte Cinema, 7 o'clock Wednesday and Thursday evening. And tickets are available ahead on Fandango if you want to take a look at the website.
Another thing I would encourage you to do is to support our local church. We have considerable expenses. We have the services of our Bible worker, who is working also as our church administrator, and we need to support that work. Also, our school requires our support, so when you're thinking of your offering, be sure and remember our local church. The time has come now when we seek the Lord in prayer. I have a list of people who have requested prayer. It's a considerable list. And would anybody else, just by raising their hand, like have a silent thing they'd like for me to remember? I will do that. Let's reverently kneel as far as possible, and we'll sing our prayer song. Our God in heaven, our hearts are filled with joy as we come into your presence this morning. We're so thankful for this opportunity to come apart and to study about you and about your word, what you want for us in our lives. But we also realize that not all people are as privileged as we are. We know that there are difficulties in this world at this time, war, indiscriminate killing and slaughter, bad things happening to good people. We would just ask that you would be with those people also as you are with us. We also would ask that your presence be in our service. May everything that has been being done be done to your honor and to your glory. We have some special requests this morning, personal requests. Mimi, John, Jory, Matt, Harry, Moses, Scott, Mary. Also some unspoken requests. There's a concern about Vera and Brad. There's evidently a cancer diagnosis in their lives. We know that it is not your will that people should suffer from this terrible disease. So many people involved. We would ask that as you, as the great physician who used to walk up and down the dusty roads of Palestine and spent a great deal of time healing the sick and comforting the brokenhearted. Beatrice has been hospitalized. We'd ask that you be by her bedside. Robert, our church member, also has health problems. Jennifer is facing issues with cancer and asking for wisdom. Mary also is a victim of cancer. And there are a number of unspoken requests also. You know the heart, you know what's wrong, and we would ask that you would be especially near to those. You saw the uplifted hands, and we don't know all of the things that are involved, but certainly you do. We have people that are kind of fading away this life and be near them, other obvious problems, lots of times health problems. So be near us today. May the angels be here with us. And may your Holy Spirit give us a special blessing on this day. In Jesus' name, amen. One further item, there's a second reading and vote for Yvonne Gordon transferring out from this church to the Seaside Church. You did it, Len?
Yeah, we did it last week.
Oh,
yes.
Sorry.
Wow, nice crowd today. So, good morning, boys and girls. Good, and good morning, adults. Question for you kids. How many disciples did Jesus have? Who knows? 12, attaboy. Out of those 12, there was an inner circle of three, Jesus, the ones closest to him. Who knows their names? Peter, John, and who? You're close. James, that's right. Good job. Kids say the darndest things. Who could tell me who's the disciple Jesus loved? Yeah. No. He loved John. The Bible tells us that. Last question. Who is the disciple Jesus spoke most frequently to? Who did he talk with? Who can pick that one out? You had it right. It's Peter, Simon Peter. What do we know about Peter? It's a rhetorical question. What do we know about Peter? What kind of man was he? What were his defining characteristics? Let me give you a few examples where Peter was front and center, and we'll see if we can make a determination. Once, Jesus and his disciples were in Caesarea Philippi. When out of the blue, they were off by themselves, Jesus said, "Who do people say I am?" And the disciples, they probably looked around at each other and went, "Well, I don't know. Some say you're John the Baptist. Others say you're Elijah. Still others say you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets." But Jesus said, "Who do you say I am?" And Peter, without a moment's hesitation, said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Does it seem to you that Peter had unquestioning faith in Jesus? Yeah, he sure did. Let's go to the Last Supper on the night before Jesus was crucified. Jesus took off his garments and proceeded to wash the disciples' feet. We all know that story, right? We wash our feet in this church based on the example of Jesus. But when he came to Peter, when it was Peter's turn to get his feet washed, Peter said, "Lord, you'll never wash my feet." What did Jesus say? He said, "If I wash not your feet, then you can have no part in me." What did Peter say then? He said, "Well, Lord, you might as well wash my hands and head while you're at it." That was a foolish response, don't you think?
Yeah.
You bet. And do you think Peter thought that through? I don't think so. Right after the washing of the feet, Jesus said to them, "Yet a little while I am with you, and then I must leave you." Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus answered, "Where I am going, you cannot follow, but you will follow me afterward." Peter said, "Afterward? Why can't I go right now? I'll die for you, Jesus." Do you think Peter meant that?
Yeah.
I kind of think he did, but again, he didn't really think things through. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was betrayed and being taken away by the mob and the Roman soldiers, when all the other disciples had fled, only Peter stayed behind. Now, did he stand there crying and wringing his hands? Oh, woe is me. What can I do? What can I do? No. Peter drew his own sword and cut off the ear of the servant of the high priest. He was ready to fight. Kids, I ask you, do you think that Peter, just one solitary man, not trained in the art of warfare, and facing 100 battle-scarred Roman soldiers, did he even have the slightest chance of prevailing against them? What do you think? No, probably not. What happened a few hours later after Jesus was taken prisoner? Peter denied even knowing Jesus. He denied 3 times, and then the rooster crowed. And at that moment, Jesus looked directly at Peter, and the Bible tells us that he went out and wept bitterly. His heart was broken. He betrayed his Lord. Last, the disciples were fishing and returning to shore. Unbeknownst to them, Jesus was standing on the shore and he asked if they had caught any fish. They said they hadn't, and Jesus told them to drop their nets once more. They caught so many fish that the nets were breaking and the weight was so great they were unable to haul the nets into the boat. The apostle Jesus loved, John, said, "It's the Lord." Upon hearing that, Peter leaped into the sea and swam the shore. You see, he just couldn't wait to fall at the feet of his Lord and Master. And the fact that his fellow apostles were struggling with the nets and the fish just didn't weigh very heavily with him. So, in conclusion, children, what kind of man do we think Peter was? You betcha, you bet. He was certainly a man of action, an instant decision. He was impulsive and often said and did things before thinking them through. He was hot-tempered. He was impatient, and he didn't like to wait. He wasn't a man to run from trouble, and he stood his ground more than once. All of these things I've told you, kids, we can draw different conclusions from them. But one thing is certain. Peter loved Jesus with all his might and strength, body and soul. Let's bow our heads. Lord Jesus, I ask your hand of blessing upon these children. May they be valiant like the Apostle Peter. May they be brave and stand up for the gospel message that Jesus is Lord, no matter what it costs them. Please watch over them as they grow. Help us as a church family to protect them, teach them, and may they walk in the saving grace of Jesus all the days of their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. You can go back to your seats.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Today's scripture reading is found in Romans 14, verse 5, and it says, "One person considers one day more sacred than another. Another considers every day alike. Each of them should be fully convinced in their own mind." Amen.
Good morning. I'd be remiss if I didn't say first, it's very good. It warms my heart to be here. And I'm so pleased to see so many faces that I know, probably some faces I don't know. Some new people have joined since I have been here. And I'm sorry my husband cannot be here to join me. He's suffering from Alzheimer's and he's in a facility at this time. I kept him at home with caretakers for as long as I could. But anyway, we want to move our program along, and it's a pleasure for me to say that my husband and I met Dr. Bill and Shirley Garber through the Adventist Day Today seminar, which started up sort of during COVID when a lot of people couldn't go to church. And so it was a Zoom meeting, and it was a Zoom meeting that was worldwide. So we had people from Australia who were Seventh-day Adventists. We had people from Africa who were Seventh-day Adventists. And people from the Scandinavian countries and Germany. One other countries, Bill, I can't think, or Shirley. Anyway, many, many countries, and it was very enjoyable because we exchanged our various experiences and so forth and understanding of the beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I know this already says this, so I'm going to make it brief, but Bill has served for 13 years at Monterey Bay Academy, which is close by to us. Oh, and by the way, Bill and Shirley are almost like neighbors because they come from the Santa Cruz area. Yeah, so and Bill was at Southern Missionary College, Andrews University now, Ohio University, and it goes on to tell a little bit in the handout about what he does now. And one of the most important things that you should know is that he is the board chairman of Adventist Today. And what is Adventist Today? Well, it's a platform supporting people of the Seventh-day Adventist experience as together we are learning from one another as we consider our Seventh-day Adventist experience in the world in which we are living. So it is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Bill Garber.
It's very nice to be here. I first was acquainted with the Pacific Grove Seventh-day Adventist Church in the spring of 1968. I haven't been back since, but it's really nice to be here today. To see you. Indeed, the church is lively. It's wonderful. As I mentioned to a couple of you, I'll share with the rest of you. When I finished my academic studies, I dressed up in the academic regalia and I stepped into the room where my grandmother stayed with my family, my parents. And I turned around slowly so she could see the colors. She had macular degeneration, so it was kind of a blend. And I said, "Grandma, what do you think?" And she looked at me and her eyes twinkled. And she said, "You're not the kind of doctor do anybody any good." Both of her sons were graduates of CME, College of Medical Evangelists. And in many ways, that's true. One man esteemeth one day above another. Another esteemeth every day the same. Let every man, every person, be fully persuaded in their own heart. Religious liberty is the rationale for this type of religious freedom. Looking around, There are many interactions regarding religious freedom today, for sure. So I look back amongst the Seventh-day Adventists. How has it been? Have we always been interested in religious liberty? In the 19th century, even before the Seventh-day Adventist denomination was founded, the notable John Nevins Andrews wrote about the significance of religious freedom in connection with his sense of the prophecies pictured in Revelation. You know, I wish I could find the citation for that, but I know where it came from. In terms of that claim, it's religiousliberty.info. And you can go there and read the story, but not the article. Religiousliberty.info. It's significant that Seventh-day Adventists registered this website. By the 1880s, Adventists began a decades-long effort to oppose various initiatives by organizations such as the National Reform Association. It was attempting to pass religious legislation in the states. The church focused much of its efforts in protesting state Sunday laws. There was a time when only Idaho and California and Arizona did not have blue laws, Sunday laws. All the other states and territories of the United States already had Sunday laws. In 1884, the church published a magazine called the Sabbath Sentinel. It explored the ideas of religious liberty. They produced 500,000 copies of that magazine for a population of only 50 million. In 1889, at a meeting at the Adventist Tabernacle in Battle Creek, Michigan, independent, just religious leaders established the National Religious Liberty Association. You know, these things kind of touch us in interesting ways. 55 years later, I was born to my family who was living in Battle Creek, Michigan. Of course, at that point, the General Conference had moved to Washington. The big name in town was Kellogg's cereal. In the declaration signed by those first 110 members, the association declared, "We deny the right of any civil government to legislate on religious questions. We believe that it's right and should be the privilege of every person to worship according to the dictates of their own conscience." In 1890, that group collected 250,000 signatures gathered by a church of only 29,000 people, only 27,000 of which were living in the United States. That's a major achievement of a small group of people for religious liberty. As activities of the association spread, in 1893, the National Association became the International Association of Religious Liberty. Let's keep in mind, this was all happening independent of the General Conference. It was not until 1901 that the Adventist Church established its first Department of Religious Liberty, and 5 years later, established the magazine Liberty. Note that the magazine from the beginning is linking fundamental liberty to freedom, and not just any freedom, religious freedom. At the time, Liberty was the only magazine on religious freedom in America, and today the magazine is the oldest continuously published journal of religious liberty and continues to advocate for religious freedom for all and for the separation of church and state. Especially important today, and I'm quoting the current Liberty editor from her editorial just previously to the current issue. She writes, "In the first issue of the magazine, the editor of Liberty argued that America is not a Christian nation, quote unquote, in the sense that its laws should enforce the specific Christian doctrines. The editor wrote that America's constitutional genius lay in recognizing that, and we quote from his presentation, no power but that of love can rightly compel the conscience. When religion becomes an affair of law, it ceases to be a matter of love. When religion becomes an affair of law, it ceases to be a matter of law, and he said, and no one has the right to bind his own theology upon anyone's back but his own. I thought they wrote quite well back in those days, too. Regardless, righteousness by faith apparently still is in the process, if you will, of infusing itself into the Seventh-day Adventist experience in those days, and still sometimes today, it seems. This is the current issue of Liberty Magazine. How many of you, and this is not a evaluation of you, I'm just interested in the circulation of this magazine in this congregation. How many of you have seen this particular issue? Wow, great. I first started reading the magazine in my family when I was a college student, and I was inspired that it goes to thought leaders around the world, certainly around this country, and I'd like to remind you, you do not have to subscribe to read the magazine. You can simply go to Liberty Magazine, all one word, .org, and you can look at any of the issues, including historical issues. It's a wonderful service. Liberty's a thin publication, 32 pages. It's respectful of your time. We live in the age of the internet. There's so much to read. They keep the story short. Looking at the current issue give you a scope of the breadth of coverage in today's religious freedom environment. First, the problem with free speech is us. The editor is opposing direct government involvement with social media. Are children mere creatures of the state, as pictured on the cover? Two authors from the University of Dayton, a Roman Catholic university, survey parental rights regarding sex and gender education in public schools. Another headline, a forgotten saga of parental rights and racial justice. Brief historical vignette that gives evidence that Black and Latino rather than white conservatives in the 1960s were leading the push for parental rights over school standards. Flipping the scripture on faith and politics. A brief by Michael Weir, whose book, The Spirit of Our Politics, notes, in politics, Christians have too often been part of the problem. Not because of what our faith requires, but in spite of it. Interesting piece. Unholy Alliance. An interview with filmmaker Dan Partland, who happens to be from Santa Cruz. His film, God and Country, is a documentary exploring Christian nationalism. Challenges mount for faith groups in Ukraine, another topic where Christian, Jewish, Muslim people are facing some issues with Russian Orthodox, because Russian Orthodox is noted as something of a proxy power supporting the Russian approach. Then, a welcome boost for religious freedom on campus. Another local story to us, San Jose Unified School District was punishing Fellowship for Christian Athletes organizations in their schools. And they were opposed to this organization because it required its leaders to subscribe to the organization's beliefs with regard to sexual conduct and marriage. Now, none of the members were required, but the leaders were, and the Ninth Circuit said, now, you can't use that to prevent that organization from being equivalent to other such organizations in your schools. Untethered is a commentary on a well-known law professor, chair of law and religion at Michigan State University. This is the case that found the football coach in Bremerton, Washington, out of line with the school because he invited student athletes who volunteered or were interested voluntarily to take a knee and pray on the football field after the game. And this professor's suggestion is that the court's ruling was more of their own personal making than of law. We finally have just a couple of items, healthcare conscience protections, where the Federal Department of Health and Human Services has listed how they are going to address the variety of laws in terms of how they implement them. And it said that both parties were supportive of their approach, and these address such things as abortion, sterilization, contraception, assisted suicide, transgender care, and so on, when federal law comes into play. And finally, a book review, Lament for Christianity's Politic Turn. A book review of Tim Alberta's The Kingdom, the Power, and the Glory, American Evangelicals in an Age of Extremism. He interviews people in the religious realm who are very supportive of Christian nationalism. These are people that believe that a conservative president will give them the right to introduce their religious values as the law of the land. Liberty last month was looking at Project 2025, building for now a conservative victory through policy, personnel, and training. This is a document you too can read, project25.org, and it is how some are hoping to take a running start if there is a conservative elected to president. We'll see how that turns out. Contemporary religious interests near us, right here, include not only San Jose Unified School District and a filmmaker in Santa Cruz, but there is some religious history involved in terms of Christian nationalism. R.J. Rushdoony, a name that is notable for being a visionary founder for Christian nationalism, spent most of the 1950s pastoring a Presbyterian church in Santa Cruz. Meanwhile, while Liberty Magazine is chronicling contemporary news with religious liberty implications, the question comes, are there personal implications for us as individuals, families, particularly those of us with Seventh-day Adventist roots and history? Our daughter-in-law earlier this week reported listening to a religious liberty video series presented last February at the Berrien Springs Village Seventh-day Adventist Church. You can look at this series as well. Just go to YouTube and search for Village SDA Church Berrien Springs, and you'll find that church, and you'll see these videos. Our daughter-in-law, mother of our 8-year-old and 13-year-old granddaughters, was really quite disquieted by the series, and at a pretty deep level. Not only personally, but as the mother of 2 children and facing a future less than certain, among the financial and social struggles that we tend to see, whether in church or beyond. The video series focuses on evidence that individuals are increasingly, we as individuals are increasingly going to face government control, especially medically and financially, while being relentlessly monitored. She said, if my credit card is turned off, how am I going to gas my car and how could I move? The video series implications are linked to the book of Revelation and not being able to buy or sell, perhaps simply because of what church you're associated with. Now, the series does not focus on a national Sunday law and its relationship to personal salvation, but rather tends to resonate historical Seventh-day Adventist fears into something literal and something present. Fear of government control had overwhelmed concern for personal salvation in this religious liberty video, it seems. I find it interesting that fear of government control is what is driving not Adventists, but evangelicals who want to install religious values as the law of the land. Christian nationalists are afraid of the government. So I guess the question comes, on what basis are people saved eternally? And how do we respond when experiencing social unrest, especially when we're a minority? My sense is there are no simple answers. Proof texts don't come to mind. Besides, proof texts are a little proof when it matters. One man esteemeth one day above another. Another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. But shouting that will not calm an angry person within spitting distance. Perhaps it'll help us if we truly come to accept others, all others, as one with us, as God's creation. No matter what day of the week we worship or whether we worship. I find hope that Paul spent the first 12 chapters of his first letter to the Corinthians describing how to get that church organized, get that church standing up, behaving properly, worshiping correctly. And after perhaps exhausting himself, he says, okay, I'm going to show you a more excellent way. And we get chapter 13. I note that in chapter 13, Paul does not tell us how to love, but simply to love, and then describes the amazing benefits. And then Paul explains why love is better than even faith or hope. Here's why. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will cease. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, we prophesy in part, but when the completeness comes, what is in part disappears. My sense is, let's not argue over what will not endure. Love endures. Thank you.
And for our final song for the service, it's going to be Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, and that's hymn number 12.
Flowers before thee, every hour's a
Happy Sabbath.
Our Father, we are mindful of your presence with us. May it be so day by day, moment by moment. May we sense your love with all with whom we are. We are grateful for this day, for being together in this place, and we give you thanks. Amen.